Yeah, I think it does say the pink one on that thing. It does, yeah. It says Joy Pink Candle. But do you have to like the other ones too?
I think so.
I bet you Mary Beth will know.
So it turned out very well. That's kind of a big thing. Now we got friends.
Morning Spectrum Church, Irvine, come on in. If you're outside, you're probably getting wet, so you're probably not outside. You're probably already in the doors. Thank you to those of you who are joining us online and just praising God for everyone's safety driving on the roads this morning. Welcome to Sunday Morning Church. So glad that you're here. We are going to start our service off with the lighting of our Advent candles.
Yeah, welcome. We want to invite you into our Advent ceremony. And today we're relighting the candles of hope and peace. And as we wait in hope for the return of our Lord, he blesses us with peace that passes understanding, found in the gift of grace through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we also light a third candle, the candle of joy, the joy of the good news of the birth of Jesus, the joy in heaven when one sinner is reborn, and the joy in the worship of our God. Can you guys join me as we read together? May we shout for joy over your salvation, and in the name of our God, set up our banners. My soul longs, yes, faints for the courts of the Lord. My heart and flesh sing for the joy to the living God. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. Just so, I tell you, there is joy before the angels of God over one sinner who repents." And finally, let's recite the scripture together and make it our prayer. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name.
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee, God of glory, Lord of love. Hearts unfold like flowers before thee, opening to the sun above. Melt the clouds of sin and sadness, drive the dark of doubt away. Giver of immortal gladness, fill us with the light of day. All thy works with joy surround thee, earth and heaven reflect thy rays. Stars and angels sing around thee, center praise. Field and forest, vale and mountain, flowery meadow, flashing sea, chanting bird and flowing fountain, call us to rejoice in thee. Mortals join the mighty chorus which the stars began. Father, love is reigning o'er us. Brother, love binds man to man. Ever singing, march we onward, victors in the midst of strife. Joyful music leads us onward in the triumph.
I'm going to teach you guys a new song this morning. It's called God is For Us, and I wanted to share a verse from Psalm 51 with you before we do so, or Psalm 5. Psalm 5, 11 and 12 says this, "But let all who take refuge in you rejoice. Let them sing joyful praises forever. Spread your protection over them, that all who love your name may be filled with joy. For you bless the godly, O Lord.
You surround them with your shield of love. Will you stand as we sing this new song together? We're going to be singing the words, "Sing with joy now, our God is for us. The Father's love is a strong and mighty fortress. Raise your voice now, no love is greater. Who can stand against us if our God is for us?" Amen.
Sure and steady, my hope is held in your hand. When castles crumble and breath is fleeting, upon this rock I will stand. Upon this rock I will stand. Jesus, Lord of all, we raise the anthem, our loudest praises ring, we crown him Lord of all.
Earlier in the service, we read the verse Romans 15:13, and that's the one that we encouraged you guys to make your prayer. And it says, "Now may the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, that you may abound in hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." And as we look and we can see that we've already lit the candles of hope and peace and joy, and the next song that we're going to sing about covers all of those topics, talking about how we were without hope and without light until God came. And yet God came and sent his son. And through his son, we have peace with God, peace with man. And because of that hope, we are filled with joy as we praise the Lord. We're filled with joy, expecting his second coming, and just filled with joy for the things that he has done for us. So let's sing about that.
Darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophets. To a virgin came the word from the throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
Praise the Father.
Praise the Father. till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death, and the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored, and the church of Christ was born. Then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By His blood and in His name and in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ who has resurrected me. Praise the Father. Praise the Son. Praise the Spirit. Three in one. God of glory. Majesty. Praise forever to the King of Kings. We praise the Father. Praise the Son. Praise the Spirit. Three in one. God of glory. Majesty. Praise forever to the King of Kings. We praise forever to the King of Kings.
God, you have done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. Lord, we are so grateful that we can gather together this morning, and we invite you into our time. In Jesus' name, amen. As you're being seated, please greet one another.
Hello. Good morning, Spectrum Church. Good to see you. Go ahead and have a seat. And welcome. Welcome on this blustery morning, and Merry Christmas as well. Yeah, it feels good. It feels a little bit Christmassy out there. Yeah, I know in lots of the country, Christmas is a time where it's snowy and really cold and kind of frozen, and this is our Southern California version of that. This is about as cold as it gets, so enjoy it. I hear we're supposed to get a storm next weekend, too, so we may do this again next weekend. I want to welcome all of you who are here this morning, all of you who are here online. Welcome to Spectrum Church. My name's Tom, and we just want to say thank you for being here, and thank you for worshiping with us. If you are new, we have some welcome cards in the back, and we'd love it if you would fill that out so we could learn a little bit more about you. And for those of you who've been here for a long time, by the way, you can take those welcome cards as well. And if you've got prayer requests or anything that you want to share with the church, that's a great way to do that. And then you can also do that by emailing the church as well. So we have some announcements today. The first one is next Sunday, December 18th, after church, there's going to be a brief meeting. And that'll be a time for the church leadership to discuss some of the church renovations, the ministry center renovations that we're planning for the near future, what those will look like, and what we'll be doing while those are happening. So quick meeting next Sunday after church, so put that in your planner. Make sure you remember that. And then, believe it or not, is it true? Yeah, the next Sunday after that, or the next weekend after that, is Christmas weekend. And so we have some special services for that weekend. Actually, on Christmas Eve, that's a Saturday, December 24th, we're going to have two services. One of them is going to be at 4 o'clock, and the other will be at 5:30. Couple things when you're thinking about that right now. First of all, get that on your calendar. Second of all, be thinking, who would you want to invite to come and join us for those Christmas Eve services? Those are such festive occasions and such a great time to come together and maybe to bring family or friends who might not normally come to church. And then for you, if you're involved with those services, because it's going to take quite a few of us to get those going, keep in mind that you can help with one and then come to the second one and enjoy it that way. The next day, Sunday, December 25th, Christmas Day, there will not be a worship service. Instead, we're encouraging everybody to be home with their families celebrating the birth of our Savior. So those are announcements for what's coming up. In addition to that, we have our normal events that happen during the week, our Wednesday prayer groups or prayer Zoom time that we have, and then youth group on Friday night. And our other events. Yes, yes. Noah's like, yes, send your kids to youth group. Finally, we want to thank you all for your giving. And as we come to the end of the year, we especially want to thank you for your generous giving. The church is in a really good place financially, and that's because of your generosity. So thanks so much for that. As you're thinking about doing that, just a reminder, you can do that in person, you can do that online, you can do that through Zelle. Now, this morning, we get the chance once again to delve into God's Word. So as we do that, we prepare to do that. Let's bow our heads really quick and prepare our hearts. Father God, Lord, we have so much to thank you for. We thank you for this weather outside. We thank you for this season. We thank you for our brothers and sisters that we're surrounded by right now. And we ask right now, Lord, that you would give us just focus and the ability to push away distractions, Lord, and to focus on your word, which we're also so thankful for. We ask that you prepare Gabe to come up and deliver that message and that we would receive it and then apply it when we leave this place. We thank you, Lord Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Tom, thank you. Oh, good morning, everybody. I also want to add my welcome to all of you and greet those of you joining us online as well. It is good to see you. I know it's maybe a little bit of a battle to get through the elements this morning, and I know a number of folks in our church are sick, so just be mindful and prayerful for those that we know who are sick, who are recovering, or especially in this season, just being extra careful perhaps and loving us in that sense and, you know, sort of protecting us from getting sick as well. Well, this as we turn to God's Word now, this Advent season, we are focusing on the art of neighboring and living out the great commandment where Jesus says the one thing that God wants most from us is to love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind and all our strength, and is to love our neighbor as ourselves. And in fact, we love God who we can't see by loving our neighbors who we can see. And in this season, in this series, we're looking at loving not just our neighbors in general, meaning other people, but loving our actual neighbors. So the people living next door to us, the people who are across the street from us, the people actually nearest to us. And we're doing it through the lens and based on the model of the incarnation, of God putting on flesh and becoming one of us and coming near to us in his son Jesus, which of course is at the very heart of the Christmas story. As John chapter 1 says, and the Message paraphrase puts it so vividly, the word became flesh and blood, referring to Jesus, and moved into the neighborhood. Now, in Jay Pathick and Dave Runyon's book, The Art of Neighboring, which we're loosely basing this series on, they note, they observe that the number one obstacle to neighboring well is time. And we all sort of get this, right? Because we all have other relationships, other commitments already. We all have different demands, all clamoring for our attention. And for a lot of us, hurry and busyness, it's a way of life, right? We run from one thing to the next. We are juggling multiple commitments. We try to fit everything in, but we never seem to have enough time to do it all. But as somebody has pointed out, love always takes time. And love is the one thing that hurried people don't have. So, if we're going to follow Jesus and live out the great commandment to love God and love our neighbors, it means we have to make the time. And as we said, we're looking at all of this based on the incarnation. So I invite you this morning to open your Bibles. Our passage today, we're going to look at Luke chapter 2. Luke chapter 2, and we're going to read verses 41 to 52. Luke 2, 41 to 52. So listen now, this is God's word. Every year, Jesus' parents went to Jerusalem for the festival of the Passover. When he was 12 years old, they went up to the festival according to the custom. After the festival was over, while his parents were returning home, the boy Jesus stayed behind in Jerusalem, but they were unaware of it. Thinking he was in their company, they traveled on for a day. Then they began looking for him among their relatives and friends. When they did not find him, they went back to Jerusalem to look for him. After 3 days, they found him in the temple courts, sitting among the teachers, listening to them and asking them questions. Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers. When his parents saw him, they were astonished. His mother said to him, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you." "Why were you searching for me?" he asked. "Didn't you know I had to be in my father's house?" But they did not understand what he was saying to them. Then he went down to Nazareth with them and was obedient to them. But his mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. Now this story here, this is the only story in the Gospels, in the accounts of Jesus' life written by Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. This is the only one that tells us something about Jesus as a boy. So we have a few stories, of course, about his birth and his infancy. And we have a lot of stories about his public ministry and his life as an adult. But this is the only story about Jesus as a boy. And so it gives us now unique insight into the incarnation, and it also provides a summary, really, of the bulk of Jesus' earthly life. So we're going to walk through this passage, and then we'll apply it as a model for how we, as Jesus' followers now, go and incarnate and enflesh God's love to our neighbors. And the first thing to notice in this story is how routine it is, how ordinary it is. See, we're told that every year, Jesus' parents, they would do this. Mary and Joseph would travel from Nazareth, their home in Nazareth, up in the northern region of Galilee, and they would travel to Jerusalem in the south for the festival of Passover, just as the Old Testament law and the books of Exodus and Deuteronomy stipulated. And here, Jesus is 12 years old, and he goes with them. Now, it's not clear whether he's always gone with them every year, or maybe this was the first time he went with them. But at age 13, Jewish boys were regarded as having reached the age of maturity, and they were ready to join the religious community as a responsible member. It's what's celebrated in the bar mitzvah, which literally means son of the commandment. So it was not uncommon for boys to attend the Jerusalem festivals a year or two before they turned 13 as a way of preparation. But think about this for a moment now. Jesus, he's 12 years old. Today we would call him a tween, right? He's in that in-between stage. He's not a child anymore, but he's not quite a teenager. He's not quite a young adult. Do you remember what you were like as a 12-year-old? Some of us don't want to remember, right? Because it's an awkward age and stage of life, right? 12 is when puberty starts, right around there. 12 is hormones and acne and bodily changes for boys. For Jesus here, it's voice cracks, voice changes. See, it's learning to be independent and to be responsible, but you're not yet there fully. See, as we celebrate Advent and we celebrate Christmas and we marvel at the incarnation, see, often we think of the baby Jesus being born, coming to us the first time. We anticipate the Lord Jesus one day coming again in his power and glory. But what's your picture now of 12-year-old Jesus? Of tween Jesus? Awkward Jesus? The late Rich Mullins was a singer and songwriter. He wrote a song called "Boy Like Me, Man Like You." in which he helps us ponder and imagine what Jesus might have been like around this stage of his life. And Mullins, in this song, he is singing to Jesus, and part of his song goes like this. He says, "You was a baby like I was once. You was crying in the early morning. You was born in a stable, Lord. Reed Memorial is where I was born. They wrapped you in swaddling clothes. Me, they dressed in baby blue. And you was a boy like I was once, but was you a boy like me? Well, I grew up around Indiana. You grew up around Galilee. And if I ever really do grow up, Lord, I want to grow up and be just like you. Well, did you grow up hungry? Did you grow up fast? Did the little girls giggle when you walked past? Did you wonder what it was that made them laugh? Did you wrestle with a dog and lick his nose? Did you play beneath the spray of a water hose? Did you ever make angels in the winter snow? Did you ever get scared playing hide and seek? Did you try not to cry when you scraped your knee? Did you ever skip a rock across a quiet creek? And did they tell you stories about the saints of old, stories about their faith? They say stories like that make a boy grow bold. Stories like that make a man walk straight. And I really may just grow up and be like you someday." See, the Lord Jesus, whom we adore and we worship and we marvel at, he was a boy. He was a tween. Now, back to the story here. After the festival, everybody starts heading home. And in those days, pilgrims would often travel together in caravans and groups. So the women and the younger children, they would be in a group. And then the men, they would be in a separate group. And then the older boys, like Jesus at this stage, the older boys might have traveled with either group. And so we can see now how Mary and Joseph, they assume Jesus was either hanging out with his friends and with the other parent. And so they didn't worry about him until they meet up at the end of the day, and Jesus is not with either of them. And he's not with their family or with their friends, and they can't find him anywhere. And we can imagine their conversation, right? Like Mary says, "Well, where's Jesus?" And Joseph says, "I don't know. I thought he was with you and the other moms." Mary says, "No, I thought he was with you and the other dads." And Joseph says, "Well, this isn't good. Like, how are we going to tell God now? Sorry, God, we lost your son." Now, those of us who are parents, who have experienced something like this, even if just for a moment, we know what a horrible feeling this is, right? It's that stomach sinking, heart in your throat, anxious panic that sets you frantically searching for your child. Now, for Mary and Joseph, it's an agonizing wait. It's an agonizing search, because remember now, they are already one day's travel removed from Jesus. And so they hurry back to Jerusalem the next day, probably get there at the end of the day. And it's not until the third day since they left him that they can go out and about the city looking for Jesus. And they finally find him in the temple courts, in the temple complex, where he's listening to and dialoguing with the religious teachers. And it says now in verse 47, "Everyone who heard him was amazed at his understanding and his answers." In other words, even as a 12-year-old, Jesus already demonstrates wisdom and a deep commitment to God's word and to the scriptures that impressed his teachers. Except Mary and Joseph, of course, they're not impressed, right? The text says they were astonished. Some translations say they were bewildered. See, they didn't know what to think. They're probably just glad. They're just relieved they found him, and probably feeling a bit guilty as well, right? Again, those of us parents, we can relate to those kinds of emotions. Now, here's the climax of the story. Mary says to Jesus, verse 48, "Son, why have you treated us like this? Your father and I have been anxiously searching for you." And more literally, that word there is, your father and I have been deeply pained, deeply distressed and worried looking for you. But in contrast to their anxiety and worry, to their concern, Jesus, he doesn't seem to be missing them, right? He just calmly asks, "Why were you searching for me? Didn't you know I had to be in my Father's house?" See, back in chapter 1, which takes place some 13 years earlier, the angel told Mary that God had chosen her And then she was going to conceive a child by the Holy Spirit, and her child, her son, would be called the Son of God. Well, here in chapter 2 now, these are the very first words of Jesus recorded in Luke's gospel, and they show his awareness that he was, in a unique way, the Son of God. And he had this special, intimate relationship with God as his heavenly Father. See, there's a subtle contrast here. Mary says, your father and I, meaning Joseph and I, we've been looking for you. But Jesus says, but I'm with my true Father. I'm with my heavenly Father. And I have to be in his house, meaning I have to be about his word and his things and his purposes. And so why does that surprise you? See, why are you anxious? Why are you so anxious looking for me? And Mary and Joseph, the text says, they don't understand what he's saying. They're probably not really thinking about what he's saying at this point. Again, they're just relieved they haven't lost God's son. Now, Jesus is not being disrespectful of Mary and Joseph, because even though he's the Son of God, at the end of the passage here, it says he went back to Nazareth with them, and he was obedient to them. And it says that Mary treasured all these things in her heart, meaning she kept pondering, she kept thinking about all these things, what the angel had told her so many years ago, and what about who her son was and who her son is, and then watching him grow up and what he says and what he does. She kept thinking about all these things. And then our passage ends here in verse 52. It says, and Jesus grew in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. Now, this one verse here, the very last verse of chapter 2, it summarizes the next 18 years or so. Because the very next time we see Jesus in the middle of chapter 3, he is about 30 years old, and he's getting baptized, and he's beginning his public ministry. So, 18 years of life, 18 years of growth packed into this one verse. And so Jesus grows from a boy into a teenager, into a young adult, into a man. And Luke doesn't, and actually none of the Gospels, they don't give us any details here. But from the rest of the Gospels, we can piece some things together and get a sense of what those years were like. So, for example, we know Jesus grew up in Nazareth under Mary and Joseph's care. And we know that Mary and Joseph, they had other sons, other daughters. They had a pretty large family. We know that Joseph was a carpenter who taught Jesus the family trade, the family business. And Joseph, he must have died during these years, because after this story, he's actually never mentioned again. So he must have died during this time. And Jesus, he would then have worked as a carpenter, as a craftsman, to provide for his mother and for his younger siblings. And we know that Jesus continued to grow in wisdom and understanding of the Hebrew Bible, of the scriptures, and in his relationship with God as he worshiped regularly in the synagogue, and he was a member of his faith community. See, a whole world of experiences, a whole life is packed into this one verse. Now, again, how does this passage, how does this story now apply to us loving our neighbors and the challenge of time? Well, I want to suggest it applies to us in at least two ways. See, when you think about it, the incarnation, again, when God put on flesh and he became one of us, he came near to us in Jesus, the incarnation shows us now the ministry of God's patience and the ministry of God's presence. You see how patient God is? You see how patient Jesus is? See, Jesus, he didn't come, he wasn't born, and then he immediately starts speaking and saying deep and profound things about God, right? Not as a miracle baby. Not as a child prodigy, not as even a precocious teen, no. Jesus' public ministry came only after 30 years of preparation. 30 years of growing and maturing physically, spiritually, relationally, vocationally. 30 years of steady faithfulness to God, to his parents, to his family, to his community. And we see how present God is, how present Jesus is, right? Jesus, he fully entered into and he experienced all the daily rhythms and routines and all the different seasons of life, including puberty, all the ordinary and the extraordinary, all the mundane and all the momentous times as well. See, all the ups and downs, all the joys and pains, just like any other first century Jewish boy and Jewish man. And only after all this did Jesus then begin his public ministry. Only then did he start preaching and teaching and healing and doing all his miracles and ultimately went to the cross to die and rise again. But his public ministry, that section that we know so much more about, it only lasted about 3 years. In other words, see, in the incarnation, in Jesus, God came near to us and he made time for us. And for 90% of Jesus' earthly life, for 30 out of 33 years, God was showing the world and he was showing us his great love for us simply through his patience and his presence. See, time and presence, these two things, they're always at the heart of love and at the heart of loving relationships, right? Because we have to be fully present with somebody. We have to listen to them. We have to share with them. We have to get to know them, to build a friendship and a relationship with them, and ultimately to love them. And all of that requires a commitment of time. And time is our most precious resource because it's so limited, right? Because we can always make more money, but we can never make more time. Once it's gone, it's gone. Which means when we give somebody our time and our presence, it is always an act of love because we're giving them what's most precious and limited in our lives. So how do we now make the time to love our neighbors? Well, I want to go back to Jay Pathick and Dave Runyon's book, because in their chapter on time, they give some very practical points of application that I think really help us love our neighbors well. And in that book, they suggest three life-balancing principles, and then I'm going to add a fourth one, okay? So the three that they give, the first one they say, is to make the main thing the main thing. Make the main thing the main thing. And what they mean by that is we need to be intentional and purposeful about how we build our lives and our calendars and our use of time around our most important priorities and commitments. So, as Jesus teaches us, it is, first of all, to love God above everything else and to prioritize time with him. And if we make him, we keep the Lord first, he's going to lead us. He's going to help us set all our other priorities. So, it's to love God first above everything else, and then it's to love our spouse if we're married. It's to love our kids or our parents. It's to love our family, who are our most immediate neighbors, both literally and relationally, and to spend time with them. And then, as we've been learning in this series, it's to love our actual neighbors and to make time to connect with them and get to know them and be present with them. So it starts there. It's to make the main thing, and then prioritize from there. Second thing they suggest is to eliminate time stealers. And it's exactly what it sounds like, okay? To learn how to stop wasting time. Because let's be honest, we all engage in activities that maybe they're not evil, they're not necessarily sinful, but in the bigger picture, they don't really contribute anything positive either to our lives, right? Like binge watching Netflix. I have been guilty of that in this month. That's my confession. You don't have to confess right now, but you know what it is. Or shopping online for hours. So not evil stuff, but just in the bigger picture, doesn't really contribute anything. And it just steals our time. It just eats away at our time that we could better spend doing something else. So eliminate those. Learn to stop wasting time. And then the third principle they suggest is to be interruptible. Be interruptible. In other words, be open and be willing to be interrupted and inconvenienced by others. And again, confession time, this is a hard one for me. And probably for you too, a lot of you, a lot of us. Because let's be honest, right? We all make plans. We all have plans. And we all want to do what we want to do when we want. But here's the thing. When we look at Jesus was busy. Right? He had a lot of important things to do. After all, he just came to save the world. That's all he came to do. So he had a lot to do, but what you notice in the Gospels is Jesus, he was never in a hurry. He was never in a rush. He was never preoccupied. He never said, I'm busy, come back later. He was never so focused on what he had to do that he missed the needs of others. And so for you and me, as we follow Jesus, see, we're to ask him now for wisdom as to what our commitments should be. What do we say yes to? What do we say no to? And then it's to ask him to help us now prioritize our time and energy wisely and realistically so that we actually have enough time and margin in our lives to be interrupted. And we can engage and we can love our neighbors when those opportunities arise. And then a fourth principle I want to suggest is for us to focus on the persons of peace. Focus on the persons of peace. See, we can be friendly. We should be friendly with all our neighbors. But the reality is, we all have limited time and energy and relational bandwidth, right? It's impossible. We just don't have the capacity to maintain deep relationships with everyone. And the truth is, not everyone's going to respond. I know you can't believe it sometimes, but not everyone's going to respond to you positively because they also have their own commitments, their own priorities. And so they're not always going to give you their time and presence. Now, Jesus actually teaches us about the person of peace later on in chapter 10, Luke chapter 10, when he sends the disciples on a short-term mission where the principle essentially is about focusing on the people with whom we have relational favor. See, a person of peace is essentially somebody who doesn't necessarily know Jesus. They don't yet know God, but they welcome us. And they're open to us, and they're responsive to us, and they want to connect with us. And so pray and discern and ask the Lord who the persons of peace might be in your neighborhood. And as the Lord reveals those and helps us make those connections, then focus on them. Invest time and energy on them, getting to know them, getting to build a friendship and relationship with them amidst all the normal everyday routines and experiences of life. And in time, as the Lord works in their lives and he works in ours, he will show us how we can best serve them and bless them and share with them God's love. Let's pray together. I want to invite you, as the band comes out, back up at this moment, to spend these next few moments, respond to God, respond to the Lord as you sense him speaking to you. Maybe for some of us, it's a time of confession. And to say, Lord, forgive me when I don't manage my time well. My time, my day, my life is a gift from you. It all belongs to you. And as we look at it, maybe even this last week, there are moments, there are stretches, there are times when we have not faithfully made use of it for the Lord and for his glory. And so maybe for some of us, I know I sort of joked about my confession, but maybe it is a time of serious confession for some of us. Perhaps for others of us, our response to the Lord this morning is to say, Lord, who is my person of peace? Or who's the family of peace in our neighborhood? And as you think about your neighbors and their faces and their names come before you, and you think about those qualities that Jesus mentions later in Luke chapter 10, they welcome you, they are open to you, they're warm towards you, they want to connect with you. Maybe somebody, it's real clear who those persons of peace or the family of peace is in your neighborhood. Maybe for some of us, it's not clear. And so maybe your prayer this morning, your commitment is to say, Lord, show me and help me be real intentional about building those relationships and loving my neighbors, loving my persons of peace. And then perhaps still for others of us, the Lord, we know our neighbors well. We love them. We have good relationships with them both. And some of them may be Christians already. Some of them may not yet know the Lord. But maybe this morning the Lord is placing upon you a burden to pray for your neighbors. Maybe there's a need in their lives that you know about. And the Lord is saying, I want you to intercede for them. I want you to pray and call down my presence, my power, my love, my grace, my wisdom, my compassion into their lives. through you. But you pray, you talk with the Lord right now. Now, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your word. We thank you most of all for your Son, Jesus. Lord Jesus, we praise you. We worship you. We thank you for coming and fully entering into the human experience, that you know what it is like to live our lives because you lived it yourself. And we thank you for your patience with us, that you came and you didn't just come for a visit, you stayed. You're still with us by your Spirit. But when you walked this earth, you stayed for years and you experienced everything we experience. And we thank you that you have saved us and you have called us to belong to you, to reflect who you are, your heart, your character, your love, to those around us. And so as you continue to lead us and guide us to love our neighbors, to love you by loving our neighbors, Lord, we thank you that you're already at work in our neighbors' hearts, in their lives, in our neighborhood. And so for all of us, as you continue to lead and guide us, especially this Advent season, Lord, help us recognize the ways in which you invite us to join you in what you're doing in their lives. And in the right time, in the right way, with the right words, that you would teach us and show us how we can serve them and bless them and show them your great love. So fill us anew with your Spirit. Guide us even this week. Help us see the opportunities you give us. We thank you for your word. We thank you for loving us. We love you, Lord Jesus. We pray in your name. Amen.
Church, will you stand as we sing this last song together?
Can we thank Becca and Scarlett and Matthew and Craig up here and these guys? I know some of you back there don't see them, but Roxanne, Amy, and Brian, thank you guys who work so hard behind the scenes. I always say these guys have the toughest job, right? Because when everything goes well, nobody notices. When something goes wrong, everybody notices. So thank you guys. Church, if you're in need of prayer this morning, members of our prayer team will be up here at the front of the room, and please come up and just pray together. If the Lord's has placed something on your heart or a burden, or you want to pray for your neighbors together with somebody, come on up. And those of you joining us online, as Tom mentioned, feel free to share those prayer needs with us. We'd love to pray for you in those ways. Receive the benediction as we follow the Lord into a new week. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, our Heavenly Father, and the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit be with all of you, with all of us. And as you love the Lord, your God, with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and you follow him, may he lead you and guide you to love your neighbors well, especially this season. Now go with God. God bless you. God bless others through you, all for the glory of God. Amen? Amen. Amen. Forgiveness for our souls, a sacrificial friend.
Jesus preached to multitudes, their backgrounds quite diverse. Though persecuted, he prevailed, no grudges did he nurse. He offered up his life for angels then did oversee and caused the stone to roll. By rising from the tomb, Christ showed that death had no control.
Jesus is the bread from heaven. Jesus is the light of the world. Jesus is the door to salvation. Jesus is my Savior and Lord. I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. I look to Him to make me whole. I want to live forever in heaven. Abba, Father, please save my soul. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus is the one true vine. Jesus is the Good Shepherd. Jesus is my Savior and Lord. He comforts me with His Holy Spirit and gives me strength when I have none. He fills my heart with songs of worship. Maranatha, our Lord, come. Jesus is from above. Jesus is the way, the truth, the life. Jesus is the resurrection. Jesus is my Savior. Jesus is the light of the world. Jesus is the door to salvation. Jesus is my Savior and Lord. Jesus is my Savior and Lord. Jesus is my Savior and Lord.
One thing I ask of you, Lord, this is what I seek. One thing I ask of you, Lord, God of the humble and meek, may I dwell in your house all the days of my life. This awesome duty, beholding your beauty, this one thing I ask, this one thing I ask.
One thing I ask of you, Lord, this is what I see. Some duty, behold.